this is a very, very special episode of Beyond because we just got to look at the PS5 Pro. And of course, joining me to talk about it, we got the cast of Beyond. We got Brian, Max, and Jada. How are we all doing?
Beyond. Good morning. We got a new PS5. Look at that.
Yes.
And it's only $700. And the stand is sold separately, by the way, just in case anyone was wondering. The stand is sold separately, but I want to kind of...
I was worried about that.
Please, let's not... That's fake news, Max. I want us to kind of break down what we saw. Of course, Mark Cerny, he hit us with the big three, which I didn't even know that there was a big three, but he talked about the big three. He talked about the PS5 Pro having a larger GPU, 45% faster rendering times, advanced ray tracing, double and sometimes tripling the speed, AI-driven upscaling, which I thought was pretty unique. What were our takeaways from this?
Well, I think my immediate reaction is this is going to be a fantastic console for people who don't own a PS5 yet and haven't played any of those games. The thing that was really missing for me from this presentation was that big new sort of killer app that says you got to buy this thing. When the PS5 launched, you know, you had a pretty rounded selection of launch games to go with it to sort of justify jumping from the PS4 to the PS5. Maybe you could trade in your PS4, get a PS5. It was 2020. We were all inside. We had nothing to do. There was a lot of good reasons to get that thing on day one. This is a significantly more expensive version of the console than the one I bought in 2020, which was $400 for the digital version, $500 for the disc-based version. And I saw a lot of really awesome benefits and bells and whistles coming to games that I've beaten already. And I don't know if I want to play those again. I really like what they're doing. I think that the idea of getting rid of the sort of choice between performance and quality is a huge, huge step. Right. And it's obviously the biggest selling point of this console because it always sucks having to do that. But there was nothing here that really said to me, you have to buy this on day one because of this game. It was just stuff I played already. And I don't know if it's, you know, if I really want to replay all these games all over again and spend $700 to do so.
Yeah, no, that's 1000% like my opinion too, Brian. You guys know me on this cast. I've played all these games that they've shown. I've probably got the platinum and all the ones they showed today. It's really tough for me to go back and want to play these games. And yes, they're going to look better. They're going to perform better. I don't see myself, if I get a PS5 Pro, I don't see myself going back for more than a sightseeing tour and maybe taking some more photos in the photo modes for these games. Mm-hmm. I'm really intrigued to go back to Horizon Forbidden West and check that one out because that game looks fantastic already. The physics with the water and everything in that game looks just amazing. So I'm excited to kind of test that one in it. And maybe Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, I need to do a second playthrough of that one still. So maybe that's one I think that's the only one that they showed. I don't have the platinum. I think that's one that I would go back and revisit on PS5 Pro, but it's not this game-changing thing that they've shown. They said, what was it? I think they said 3/4 or 2/3 of players choose performance over fidelity. That makes sense.
Yeah.
We want those nice frames. We don't want to get in a boss fight and miss a dodge or a parry because of lower frames. And so it's nice to, it's going to be nice to not have to choose as much or have as much of a penalty when you choose performance or fidelity mode, depending on what you prefer. But this is a tough pill to swallow for most consumers at that $700 price tag for these. I don't want to say marginal because those percentage increases are nice percentage increases, but for what gamers already get, until people see it in action and have it in their hands, I think it's going to look marginal to them.
But I was watching this, you know, on my laptop hooked up to a, you know, fiber internet hardwired thing, and I have it on the highest possible YouTube settings, and I'm still kind of doing a what's wrong with this picture comparison shot, trying to figure out, you know, where are the actual improvements? Mark Cerny really had to kind of guide our eye to be like, here's where this is really showcasing the power of the PS5 Pro. And it's kind of an Emperor's New Clothes thing. Because did the trees really look that bad in Spider-Man? not really
at all. Yeah.
No.
No.
Like, were you upset at the crowd in Ration? I didn't even know there was a crowd.
Ripped apart.
Looking at the crowd. Like, there's,
yeah, at the yeah. background.
The other thing that jumped out at me is how many of these games are on PS4? Like, that's the thing. The thing that's holding back next gen is not next gen hardware. It's the fact that people haven't migrated enough. It's the fact that PS4 has such a massive, massive install base that developers aren't really, they're not really, there's no incentive to push things further. And if anything, as just demonstrated by Concord, pushing the boundaries, trying to make this very polished, incredibly high-tech thing that takes 8 years to develop is a detriment to getting the game out there and getting people playing it. Like, the problem with games is not that they're not pretty enough. The problem is that they're too pretty. The problem is that it takes too much time to make these games. And again, like, you look at the most popular games that are being played on PlayStation, most of them came out in like 2016 or 2017, and they just gotten regular updates. Like,
their game, the most popular currently and for years now, have been annualized sports games and shooting games and games as a service games like Fortnite, which people play on their phones. Max, you brought up something that, like, the statistical overwhelming majority of PlayStation users are still playing on PS4. There are more people playing on PS4 than PS5, which asks several questions. One, what will get them to buy a PS5? And two, is it a $700 console? I don't think it is. I think that the reason they're playing on PS4 is because it's getting most of the games that they want. The rest are pretty much going to PC out of a handful of a few of them. Most notably recently, Astro Bot, which is probably my game of the year. Adore that game. At no point in that game did I say, you know, I need to choose between these graphical settings. There aren't enough sprinkles on the ice cream level here. I really need the power of the PS5 Pro for that. I don't want to be cynical about this thing, but I do think it is attempting to solve a problem that in an incorrect way. Like, you need more people to migrate from PS4 to PS5, and I don't think a $700 price tag is what's holding them back in, yeah.
The PS4 Pro, not to just kind of compare these things left and right, but like, the PS4 Pro was an answer to a question that people were asking. Like, people were getting 4K TVs at the time, and you still had a console that was outputting 1080p.
Right.
People wanted higher frame rates. Mm-hmm. People wanted HDR. That was a literal difference between night and day when you were looking at, like, the shadows in HDR. They were showing off. I remember they were also, they showcased upcoming games when they revealed the PS4 Pro. I think Days Gone was still on the... And they were like, check out how these hordes of zombies look with the PS4 Pro. This is impressive. They didn't show us anything that isn't out yet with this thing, which
that's right.
Yeah. And again, that goes back to Sony not having anything. Like, we don't know what's coming out next. Like, Wolverine, we haven't seen anything from that. Like,
I want to point out a major sticking point here too. The PS4 launched at $399, right? $400 for shorthand. It then dropped by $100 by the time the PS4 Pro came out and launched at $400. So you're looking at a system that when that launched, you had a choice between a $300 entry point into the current generation or $100 more and you got 4K HDR. Right now, we're looking at a situation where the base cost of the PS5 globally has gone up in many territories. It hasn't price dropped. It hasn't gone down. They just raised prices on controllers the other day. They launched the PSVR 2 for $550. So this is now $700, which is $300 more than the PS4 digital that I bought in 2020. That's a huge ask. What made the pill to swallow a little easier for me on the PS4 Pro upgrade was that I traded in my PS4 for a PS4 Pro. I don't remember how much I got for it, but I don't remember spending more than like $150, $200 for it. I think I got a pretty good deal on it because the system had only been 3 years old at the time. The PS5 is currently 4 years old, turns four in a month or two. And I don't know what I would get if I traded that in towards this thing. I have a feeling I would probably end up paying $300-something out of pocket at the least, maybe $400 out of pocket, right? Who's going to, like, what are they going to give me for that thing? So $400 to basically see the crowds in Ratchet. Like, I don't want to be reductive about it, but like, you're right. Like, we didn't see the big next thing that's going to sell people on why they need this. Obviously, it's going to be future proofed. This console and whatever Xbox does are going to be the definitive place to play Grand Theft Auto 6, right? The biggest, arguably the biggest media event of the decade. if assuming it ever comes out. And it's going to add a bunch of bells and whistles to things you already want. But to you know, kind of pull up that point Max talked about earlier, the issue right now is that we have 7 to 8 year long development times for AAA games because we're you know, quite literally forest from the trees. We have to spend years and years, you know, making water textures and individual leaves. And then a game like Astro Bot comes out that took just a few years to make and had a small studio. It's the most highly reviewed game of the year. It's likely going to win Game of the Year or at least be nominated in the top three. And I think that that's what people are looking for. You know, like you can play Fortnite at max settings on your PC, but most people aren't. Like a lot of people are playing that game on Switch. Nintendo has the best-selling console of this generation or whatever generation they're in, and they don't even make 4K games officially. 7 years after that system launched, everything they put out is still 1080p. You know, like they're making a Zelda game and a Mario Party game this fall, and no one's like, oh, where are the 4K textures? Like it's, I feel like we're getting a little too lost here, and I feel like Sony is basically saying we want the customers to deal with it and recoup. Like this is for a very small and specific group of people. Now, $700 is a great deal for what this thing can do comparatively when you look at building a gaming PC yourself, right? You're getting a fantastic value there, and I want to stress that. I don't want to undermine that. But you're also getting a walled garden of a console, whereas the flexibility of a gaming PC is that you're going to get a lot of these same games. You're going to have the modular components where you can swap in and out over time. This is going to carry you over onto the PlayStation 6, basically. And if that's something that interests you, then sure, get it. But I genuinely don't see this moving the needle for PlayStation. I don't see this moving people off of the PS4 generation. I think they're going to largely look up and be like, I still get my Call of Duties and my Maddens and my FIFAs and my Fortnites and my Apexes, and I'm going to play those over and over and over again until my system explodes.
Oh, back to your earlier point, like the price point is a huge thing. Like one of the things that was exciting about the PS4 Pro was this sense of like, oh, just when your launch PS4 was starting to feel like a little bit long in the tooth, a little bit, you know, you're like, oh, that feels like a while ago. And also, like, I don't know, three or four years later, it's like the $400 you spent back then, it kind of feels like you kind of forgot about how much that hurt. Sony just made the DualSense more expensive. Mm-hmm. Like, they're making things more expensive and then announcing a thing that's more expensive. And it's moving the goalposts in the wrong direction. And I just don't see it. I mean, you'd think that this announcement would also come with, hey, a price cut for the base PS5. And people are like, hey, cool, I'll check out the PS5. I don't know if you need a pro. I'm not really a professional PlayStation player. I'm just more of an amateur. Let me get in on this, the ground floor. But like, yeah, there's nothing here that really, this feels like it was for Mark Cerny. Like, I love the dude. He's brilliant. He's clearly like, he's a quantifiable genius. And it's like really cool to see him get to show off the stuff he's been working on. And I'm fascinated by this. I love to watch like this dude's, you know, GDC talks and stuff like that. He's, you know, he's brilliant. And it's really cool to see technology being pushed. But at the same time, it's kind of like, I mean, I made the comparison on one of our shows that it's like a supercar. You know, it's like a Lamborghini that goes 500 miles an hour, which is cool. Where can you drive a car 500 miles an hour? Who can afford a car that goes 500 miles an hour? How many people can actually safely drive the car 500 miles an hour? You're missing this infrastructure. How many developers can afford to make games that actually take full advantage of the system? And at that point,
I need to point out some more interesting stuff too. And I think some of you are going to be very upset by this listening. That's an all digital console. That is a $700 console that doesn't have a disc drive. So you will need to purchase that separately and add it on if you are a physical game collector, which I know a lot of you are. Me, I'm all digital. So whatever. But a lot of you, especially in this day and age where games are getting delisted and disappearing and need, you know, massive updates and patches and all of a sudden have online modes and all that stuff, you are going to need an add-on for this. So unless you are completely all digital, that $700 price point doesn't even begin to scratch the surface for you. You're going to have to buy an additional thing to you know, slap that beer gut on the side of your PS5 Pro and start from scratch over there. Pre-orders do go live on the 26th, if that's something you're interested in. I'm seeing, you know, a couple more details spin out about this thing. But yeah, you're going to need a disc drive for the PS5 Pro. So on top of that $700 in America, and even more elsewhere, you'll need a disk drive if that's
did they announce the hard drive
$80
size?
$80 for the slim PS5 disk drive is $80.
Okay, so yeah, so you're like, looking at $780 for the PS5 Pro if right. you have a disk that you would like to play at some point in the next 5 years until PS6 comes out.
Well, look, I'm getting this thing. My uncle Scrooge McDuck, so I'm definitely going to get this thing. But anyways, I want to talk about something. Like, look, I think what they should have shown us to kind of justify the price tag is something new. Obviously, I know this isn't a state of play, but they probably should have showed us like something new, like new game footage from one of the upcoming games. But I don't want to dogpile too much. I feel like you all did a great job. Like, I want to talk a little bit positively about this thing, you know, about this sure. PS5 yeah. Pro. Again, I'm looking at this from the standpoint of like someone who's like super excited for Grand Theft Auto 6, which is coming out next year. And I feel like we're really going to see this thing shine. We're really going to see that game shine on the PS5 Pro next year. And all the other games that are coming out next year. I think that's essentially why, you know, this is dropping now, dropping in November. Obviously, that price tag is definitely what, again, a lot of people are gonna. I mean, like $700 is a lot of money, and you know, I mean, like how much did I pay for the PSVR 2? And we see, you know, how happy I am with that piece of hardware. So,
yeah, two on the block, oh, that's cool. which is that's a sizable improvement. That is substantial. That yes. feels like, and again, like SSD. You know, storage space is not cheap, so that kind of takes a little bit of the burn off of that price tag. Again, still, it's just, yeah.
Yeah, it's another thing I will say is, to the testament of the PS5, even the base model, if you remember back the PS4 base models, when we were hearing about the PS4 Pros, the PS4 base models were sounding like jet engines. They were getting really loud, overheating. Yeah. There's a lot of those issues. And so that was another reason for us to incentive for us to upgrade to a PS4 Pro. The PS5 base model doesn't generally have that issue. I've heard some people's PlayStation 5s are a little bit louder. I don't know if the PS5 Pro is going to solve any of that, but that was one of the other things we had last generation's upgrade had for it. This one, I don't think needs that type of benefit. But to Akeem's point about some positive things, they're ray tracing. They talked a lot about ray tracing. And while I'm not the biggest fan of ray tracing, it's not like it's not an essential thing that I consider when I'm picking up a game. Like
right.
this ray tracing is going to make this game so much better. I'm going to have 10% more fun. It doesn't work that way. It's just like, oh, this is going to look great. And there is a good library of PS5 games that use ray tracing. Things like Gran Turismo 7, Hitman 3, you know, they showed Hogwarts Legacy, there's Resident Evil 7, Star Wars Jedi Survivor. There's a lot of great games that have that ray tracing that really benefit from it. So getting a more improved ray tracing and having it more access to more games is going to be seen as a improvement for those who do decide to pick up the Pro.
Yeah,
I just don't know if that is... I don't know if the audience that considers ray tracing the end-all, be-all, best thing to come to gaming is a big enough audience to justify the bigger price incentive.
Who was waiting?
I think it's a great addition.
Who was waiting to play these games? Like, they show Hogwarts. That was the best-selling game of last year. Like, The Last mm-hmm. of Us 1 and 2 are phenomenal titles. Two of the greatest video game stories ever made. I love them dearly. I never want to see them again. You know, like, I've played those games. I've enjoyed them. I've beaten them. Spider-Man 2 was a blast. It was awesome. It sold really well. I don't need to play that game again. Like, who is looking at this and saying, like, oh, wow, I've never heard of any of these titles before. Like, almost all of these games were, like, hit best-selling games. They were either the best-selling games of the month they were released or best-selling games of the years they were released.
Wait. This is the sizzle that you should show alongside a price cut announcement. This is the kind yes. of thing we used yes. to get exactly. when they're like, hey, it's the PS4 Slim coming out this holiday season for $299 or whatever it was.
Yep.
Is that what Apple does?
I feel like Apple does that, don't they? Like when they mm-hmm. show a new iPhone and they cut the previous phone
the
down.
On the old one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like that should have been something that we should have seen.
I think that by and large, and we can probably all agree here, that the mid-gen console refresh ideology, right, which is something that largely started last generation, unless you want to count stuff like the N64 expansion pack, which, you know, came bundled with Donkey Kong 64. it was largely to basically split the fan base into people who really, really care about next generation graphics, and also at the same time, service an audience who hasn't come into the building yet, right? And like you just nailed it, Akeem, like that is an idea that was basically taken from Apple and mobile phone companies in general, being like, we're going to put out a more powerful one every single year, right? They just announced the iPhone 16 yesterday. I didn't even bother looking at it because I was just like, my 15 Pro Max is awesome. I'll look at this when I need to see it. Nothing really was like, you have to get this. But at the same time, they dropped the price on older models. You can get into the Apple or Android sort of, you know, space if you want to at any entry point. Whereas on PlayStation, like there's a PS5, there's a PS5 Pro, and those have two locked price points. Like I said before, they literally just raised the price of the PS5 in Japan because of taxes and all this other nonsense. They raised the price over there. That was preceding this announcement where they announced the most expensive consumer-based console ever made that also doesn't come with a disc drive. Like, I'm sorry. Like, I'm kind of flabbergasted by this. This thing with a disc drive and taxes costs double the price of the PS4 costs. Like, just about. Like, that's insane. And say you want a second controller to go with it, they just hiked the price on that too. What are we doing?
Yeah. I mean, the PS3, remember the PS3 debacle? There was so much issue with launch PS3s and their high price points. And we thought Sony learned from those higher price points after that PS3 era when they came out with the PS4 at a lower price point. And then the PS5 came out at that, you know, right around that same range of a better price point for consumers. And now we're just kind of back at that point.
No, it's a pendulum swing. Like, it's this sort of hubris where, like, the PS3... the backlash to that kind of humbled them. And then PS4, they came back swinging, and then that put them on top. And then this gen, they're like, they're doing well, they're selling just fine. But I feel like in a way that's kind of not really benefiting anybody. Someone pointed out yesterday was the anniversary of the Dreamcast release. And I'm just like, oh yeah, that really expensive thing that came out kind of mid console generation and was like, you know, too powerful for the time and not powerful enough for the next time and somewhere in the middle. And just, you know, a lot of people loved it. Again, that was also trying new things. Going back to the phone comparison, there was that point where, like, when Apple would announce a new iPhone, people would be like, oh, I got to get this thing. And like, that time has long since passed. Like, I feel like most people, and again, part of that is because the tech kind of ran out of places to go. Like, you're kind of like, how many more megapixels can you actually add in a way that makes it impressive? How many more, you know, features can you add without completely leaving everybody with earlier models behind, but also making something that people want? And like,
right.
Yeah, we're kind of there with the consoles too. And it's this whole thing just kind of feels like a monkey wrench, because now, like, developers are going to be pressured to make their games really sing on the PS5 Pro, which is more time and resources taking away from just making the games. And yeah, this, I don't know, this, I don't know who this is for. I don't know who this device is for.
I don't see this moving the needle for the average game fan right now. I don't see this moving the needle for the average consumer who globally is feeling the pain in their wallet and purse, right? Like, it's incredibly expensive to go anywhere and do anything right now. And so I just don't really see the average person saying, hey, I could buy 10 games for the price of this thing at 70 bucks a pop.
Yeah.
Yep.
Brian, what game are you looking forward to most from play? What PlayStation 5 exclusive title are you most anticipating?
I don't know. I mean, I just adored Astro Bot. And again, like, at no point during that game was I like, God, this thing's ugly.
No, I mean, it's a trick question. Like, what are the PS5 exclusives we know about?
I mean, I want to control Wolverine? Better battery life. That's,
we're waiting on Wolverine.
We've seen the CG trailer. They haven't shown anything that benefits from this. So Sony's job right now, I mean, their job is to make, you know, electronics for a global corporation, but whatever. Mm-hmm. But they need to come out swinging next year and really justify why this thing exists.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
If we don't see, if the stuff there, if they're not, if they don't come out with like a library of games that is really taking advantage of a $700 console, what are we doing? What are we doing here? Why would, like, again, Sony at its core is a electronics company. Their goal is to make electronics. They make consumer electronics. They've been making, you know, stereo systems and Walkmans and rice cookers since the end of World War II. Like, they've been around for a while. That's their entire MO. Meanwhile, you look at Microsoft. They are a software company. They make software. They make operating systems. You look at Nintendo. They're a toy company. They're a game company. And you see these corporations kind of lean in those various directions, and they have these kind of these habits. And in this case, it just really feels like, you know, this is a high-end stereo component, but like, it's not. There's the scene in Boogie Nights where, you know, Don Cheadle is working at the hi-fi stereo and he's trying to sell people on why they really need like a new hi-fi system with the subwoofer that makes you want a freaky deaky. And the people are like, yeah, I just don't hear it, man. It's not really moving the needle for me. And that's kind of where we're at. Like, it's just, it's escalation. It's, you know, you're just trying to sell the next big thing. And like, that's definitely appeals to some people. And it's going to be like, if you have a choice of buying a new console right now, or this fall, I guess, weird time to buy a new console, but this is going to be the one that future proofs you the most until they announce the next thing.
Right. Yeah. I mean, how many of the games that we saw today are currently on PC?
Quite a bit.
95% of them.
Right. For the most part.
And so if you truly deeply care about playing these games at the best possible settings humanly possible and imaginable, while also owning a modular box, which admittedly is going to be way more expensive to build than a PS5 Pro. I want to make that abundantly clear. If you build a PC with these specs, it will cost you more. But you will have access to a massive library of games from the last few decades and not a walled garden. You will have access to mods. You will have access to emulation. You will have access to Steam, you know, and GOG and the Epic Game Store and a million other things. And like, I'm a console guy. I like to sit down at the end of the day and turn on my little box and hold my controller and not have to worry about any of it. Right. I just want to play games. I have gaming PCs. I enjoy playing games on those too. But I like, at the end of the day, I like to play console games. But if you really truly care about playing these games at the best possible settings, like, you're probably going to build the PC. And in a few years in, you're going to swap out the cooling system and the graphics cards and all the other stuff, right? You're going to add more RAM. Like, all of that stuff is that's the way PC players build. Like, they have a box, it's modular, they swap parts in and out, and they spend that kind of money every couple of years rather than just like trading in a console they bought and getting a new one. And most of the games we saw today, God of War, Ghost of Tsushima, you know, Hogwarts, all that stuff, are all on PC, where they sold incredibly well, where you can play them and you can add mods and you can do whatever you want. And so I struggle to really find exactly where this is going for Sony without knowing what they're working on next. And we've all said it, and I will say it again. We have not seen Ghost of Tsushima 2. We have not seen The Last of Us Part 3. We don't know what Santa Monica's working on after God of War Ragnarok released. We know Wolverine's coming, right? But like, we haven't seen it in ages outside of leaks. So instead, we're forced to just look at these same six games over and over and over again that have been released and re-released and remastered and remade. And where the F is Bloodborne? That's how that really done it for me today. That really would have got me to go like,
I was waiting for you to bring the Bloodborne into the conversation.
I mean,
look, Ryan,
we're 40 minutes into this and we haven't said the B word yet. Where is Bloodborne? Where's the 60 FPS Bloodborne? There are people that have gotten that running on PC this week. Like, I'm tracking that whole community. I'm tracking that whole scene. I'm fascinated by it. And you know, the fans are going to have to do what Sony isn't doing. And instead of taking a beloved video game from almost a decade ago that's locked at sub 30 FPS and 720, 1080p or whatever it is, with screen tearing, dithering and all this other garbage, they haven't shown us that. They just show me the stupid crowd and Ratchet and Clank that I don't even remember being in that game.
So speaking of crowds, I've been like watching chat I've been watching chat throughout the stream, and you know, there are a lot of people that are agreeing with our sentiments, but there's also a decent portion that are like, I'm that target market. I'm the person that this is for. I don't care. I'm going to spend the money. I want that best performance. And that's great. And like Brian was saying, like, we don't want to rain on your parade. We want you to enjoy what you want to enjoy, spend your money how you want to spend it. And if this is the choice for you, go for it. I also took a look at, we're running a Twitter poll right now. So you can go to IGN's Twitter and vote there to make your voices heard chat. But right now it's like 82-83% that are not interested in this PS5 vote. Granted, it's still early. The poll's only been open for an hour. That may swing a little bit, but it's at something like 10,000 votes right now, which is very small sample size. So mm-hmm. I won't couch it in that. But, you know, 8,000 of those 10,000 people just aren't hearing it. And I really want this PS5 Pro, but I can't want it more than Sony wants me to have it.
Right.
You know, and we need the games. We need to see what's coming.
What's it for? It's for playing games. What are these games? These are games we already played. Like, it does feel like one hand doesn't know what the other one's doing. And like the hardware department is like clearly ready to come out and be like, hey, check it out. We made this cool thing. And Sony has games in the works. We know that. We don't know how many of them have been canceled following recent live service game debacles, but there are things in the works. There are things cooking. And there's a stretch there where Sony would come out at E3 and they'd be like, check it out. Here's what we got in the works. And they would show all these cool things. They'd show us all these awesome, you know, sizzle trailers, logo reveals, stuff like that. And then we would spend 3-4 years being like, where is it? Where's mm-hmm. Spider-Man? We all sound like J. Jonah Jameson. We're like, bring me pictures of Spider-Man. Show me that wall crawler. And like, we're at this point where like we know that Wolverine's coming. Yeah. We know that GTA 6 is coming. Those are both going to be like, those are games I will play in a heartbeat. Fantastic. Those are both, I'm sold. Nope, no questions asked. But again, put a picture of Wolverine next to the new PlayStation. Get a single side-by-side screenshot from Rockstar. Rockstar is totally just like over there eating popcorn being like, we're fine, we're cool. People are going to buy this on everything. They don't have to worry about a damn thing. But it would be nice if, I don't know, somebody drove a dump truck up to money of somebody else's house and got some studios on board, got something to be excited about. Because right now it's when you're like, check out what Hogwarts Legacy looks like. Okay, and that's on Switch, dude.
Like, yeah. Borderlands 3? They're showing like Borderlands 3. It's like these games aren't. I don't even think they chose the best like technical marvels to show this off. I don't remember. I might have missed it, but I don't remember seeing any GT7, one of the like most graphically impressive games on the PS5, that would have sung with showing some of this ray tracing stuff.
They showed like, some Gran Turismo 7 in there.
Did they show some?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did they show some GT7? I just missed it. Okay.
Again, GT7.
They showed it's on Star PS4. Wars Jedi Survivor.
And Max, Star Wars Jedi Survivor is coming to PS4. Like,
it just got it's getting a last gen port. And the issues with that game weren't ray tracing. It was that it was sort of a technical mess at launch. Mm-hmm. And they spent some time fixing it and cleaning it up. But like, that wasn't the issue. Star Wars Outlaws, which is a game I love, right? I had to choose between performance and graphics on that game too. That game's getting patched because the stealth sequences in the beginning are too tough. Like,
just like pass fail. Like, yeah, they're too binary.
Exactly.
Not like too tough, but they're too binary. And that's just an issue.
This won't fix that. I want to point out, IGN just tweeted this out. They said the PS5 Pro is quite a bit more expensive in the UK than it is in the US. So for $700 in the US, that is a conversion rate of $914.35 in the UK. And again, no disk drive. So with a disk drive, you're looking at $1,000. And I know, that in the UK, they save a lot of money by not seasoning their food ever. And that's okay. You guys save hundreds of dollars a year by not buying paprika or garlic powder, salt, black pepper, all those things. But still, that's a lot of money. And I feel for you guys.
Yeah. So we're fortunate enough to be doing this live right now. So we have chat going, and like Jada said, there are a lot of people that are sharing our sentiments. We're being I wouldn't say hypercritical of it, because I'm looking at these comments, and there's one commenter here, Betray, says you can get a 4070 Super for $520 right now. You can stick with that with an older system and get PS5 Pro graphics today and a way bigger games catalog, which is true. Like, you can build a PC right now for that amount of money, like a pretty decent PC for $700 if you source the parts right. So it's like, I feel like that right there, the price tag more than anything else is what's going to turn people off. Because if you don't already, if you are not already bought or sold into the PS5 as a console, because like maybe you're waiting for a price break. Seeing $700 and the PS5, is that still 500, I believe?
Or 550 in Japan.
Yeah, like you're still gonna like probably hold off, and you're looking at the life cycle. You're like, all right, how many years are we into the PS5? Maybe the PS6 is gonna come out at some point, maybe a year, 2 years from now. Let me keep holding off, because like maybe you're a casual gamer, or maybe you're a PC gamer, so you're not like huge into consoles right now. So I don't know. I like, that's why like Cerny didn't like you, okay, when you watch an Apple presentation, they show you the price of the new phones, and they're still on that stage. They drop what we're seeing, this screen, and then that was the end of it. No one said anything, yeah. Like, because they knew people, if there was a live audience watching this presentation, this technical presentation, we would have been like breaking our phones and like throwing paper in the air, like, what 700? We would have been so upset seeing that in a crowd.
Can we show that promotional image again? Because I just want to point out, they did it, they hit it so you don't see that there's no disk drive, which again, you'll need separately. And the vertical stand, it's standing up in this picture. If you don't buy that thing, it's just going to be sleeping on its side.
It'll still stand without the stand though, right? It can still stand.
But again, like, okay, let's talk about the PSVR 2 real quick, which I know Sony hasn't done in 2 years. The PSVR 2 launched at $550, which is incredibly expensive for a virtual reality hat, but comparatively to the power and the tech you would get in competing devices, a good deal. But something is only worth, in video game land, the software you can play on it. And they did not do a good enough job today of showing the audience, showing the user base that there is a compelling enough reason to purchase this thing. They just victory lapped on stuff we've all played already that we had no problem looking at the time. A lot of those games I played on PS4. Like, I don't care. I played a Ghost of Tsushima and The Last of Us Part 2 on PS4. They were two of the best looking games ever made. They saved my mental health during the pandemic. Like, I loved those games so much. And at no point was I like, this ugly piece of garbage. They did not show the roadmap for the future. They showed a bunch of games that we played and beaten already. And they showed a price tag that's one of the biggest sticker shocks I've ever seen since covering this industry for the last 15 years. And at no point do I think the average consumer is going to look at that thing and go, you sold me on it. You showed me this low bit rate live stream at 7 o'clock in the morning or 8 o'clock in the morning with a very lovely scientist man who comes out with the energy of the guy that no one listens to at the beginning of an apocalypse movie. And he tried to show us these low quality videos of slightly more leaves on the trees and slightly more people in the crowd and Ratchet and Clank.
With the power of the PS5 Pro, you'll finally be able to see the forest for the trees, thanks to enhanced AI-driven ray tracing.
Man, and I'm looking at Twitter right now, and the average consumer is just like, "What are they doing? What is this? What is happening this generation?"
You also have to remember, a large chunk of the audience that Sony is trying to bring into the PlayStation family with games like Astro and trying to capitalize on this younger demographic, those consoles are going to be bought by parents during holiday times. The consoles launching during holiday times. The parents that are informed and know about the differences between the PS5 and PS5 Pro, they're already going to have a PlayStation in the household.
Yes.
They may be the ones that are well off and can afford to go ahead and just buy an additional console for the house. They're going to do that. They're going to be like, cool, I'll get the PS5 Pro and I'll give the regular PS5 to my child.
Yeah.
However, the ones that are the kids that are coming of age and their parents are like, I'm going to get my kid a PS5 this year. They've been great in school. They've been doing everything they need to do. I'm going to get them a PS5. They're going to go to the store and they're going to be like, do I get a regular PS5 or do I get a PS5 Pro? What's the difference? It's like, oh, this one looks a little bit better. Is that worth the extra $200-$300
If I picked up my kid from first grade today and the teacher said, your kid is so good, she's like Matilda levels of reading, we want to jump her straight to college, I would be undeniably prouder of her than I've ever been of anyone in my entire life. And I still wouldn't spend $700 on buying her a video game system, because I'm a parent and that's a lot of money. And there's a lot of things you can get with that. And to your point, Jada, what they should be doing this fall is launching a $350 bundle that comes with the launch model PS5 and Astro Bot. So you can put it underneath your Christmas tree, right? So you can get it for your kids for the holidays. It's why Nintendo every single year goes, here's the Switch with Mario Kart again and again and again. And it just becomes the best selling console all the time. Like, Get people into the entry point. Make them PlayStation fans for life. $700 is how you keep people from being $700 PlayStation fans forever, right? They're going to stay outside of that wall forever. They're not going to come in. You need to get new people in. You need to get new generations in.
You're going to have an entire... What's funny is on the press release for this, they say it includes a copy of Astro's Playroom.
Oh, come on. Most people don't even know that's on their system.
You can just if you charge people $700 for a console, maybe just include the thing you just put out. Put the new one on there. That would be just such a I want that game to sell. I want people to go out and buy it. But also if you're going to charge, I feel like that's got to be something you could maybe just drag and drop it on there. Be like, oh, and play the brand new Astro game. It comes preloaded on this new system. Not the one that came out crazy. 4 years ago.
Yeah. It's crazy. And I know, I don't think PlayStation generally does bundles when they launch a refresh, like an actual refresh console. I don't remember them doing bundles with the PS4 Pro or the PS3 Slim / PS3 Pro that they did. But there's always a first for anything. And when you're starting to raise the price on the console mid-generation, maybe you need to look into what the consumer is going to look at when they're buying this and help them see the value in this. Because looking at a box and seeing a bunch of numbers and abilities that this console can do isn't for those that are financially concerned about spending this amount of money, that is not a benefit to them. That the benefit is, what all can I get for this $700?
Yep.
Oh, cool. I get a game with it. Oh, cool. I get it. It comes with a second controller. Oh, cool. It comes with a headset. I'm not saying for Sony to include all of those things, but one of those things, pick one, Sony. And I think this becomes a much easier pill to swallow for those fans that are on the fence about spending this exorbitant amount of money on a console.
Yes. Yes.
You know what? Now that we know what the PS5 Pro looks like, I'm kind of curious. Do you think there's going to be some DLC of it for Astro Bot? We can make that spaceship look like the PS. I want those stripes on the sides.
I would hope that would recognize which console you're playing on, and it would just automatically update. I would hope that would be the case, but I don't think that is going to be the thing.
I mean, the whole no spoilers, but there's an entire sequence towards the end where you and all the bots you collected are on the top of a PS5 and they'd be all tripping over the grooves in there and all that, you know.
it's messing with the level design, Brian.
If we were to write a top 100 list, which we're very prone to do at IGN, of why this PS5 Pro is a bad idea, the bots tripping over the grooves in Astro is pretty low, right?
Well, but still, they we were talking about this before there was the leaked image someone put out that had three stripes on it, and the actual thing you could see it has three little vents, and we were going back and forth of can they legally have three stripes on it without it without Adidas suing them? That's their brand. That's the brand with the three stripes. But I'm also looking at it and I'm like, if they don't do a Wolverine bundle that's bright yellow and blue in the middle, I'm gonna be so mad.
Great news, they won't.
Like Wolverine just went and scratched the thing up. It's got stripes on the side of it, like Wolverine. Just what?
I don't know. You already know a third party is going to do that, though. I'm assuming those plates can pop off just the original PS5.
Slim. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, maybe that's the play. That's the play, guys. If you want your console to look like Wolverine, you're going to have to spend $700 so you can get the Wolverine special faceplates that blend perfectly into the little stripes.
I like how sometimes we come out here, we're like, here's some valid criticism and feedback, and other times we just shout stuff a third grader would say in 1996. And just, why doesn't it look like Wolverine? I want to see what it looks like side by side with the base model, because we got that little unofficial slim version. They shrunk it down a tiny bit, and then now it's bigger again. And I'm like, how what does this look like? what is the size of this thing?
One of you brought up the PS3 price reveal, $599 US dollars. That was, one of the earliest internet video game memes I remember just blowing up. It's been a long time since I think I've witnessed a moment like that happening again in this industry. And today was it. I think that this was there, and it's you know, this we get it. We get it every couple of years. We get that cocky Sony comes back, right? The PS4 generation historically was defined at E3 when, they in contrast to what Xbox had shown with Don Matrick and the always online and the games locked to a blah, 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 you can't give somebody else, had what looked, you know, a very crude shot on a phone example of here's how you share games on PS4, right? And it was handing a game to another person, then you go, thanks, right? They won E3 that year. They won the generation because of it. And because of winning that generation, where people built up digital libraries for the first time, you could probably argue that carried them into this generation as well, right? A series of baffling decisions across the board on the other companies have led to other places where we are right now. But to me, this is their return. This is their 4K, 60 FPS, ray traced, no decision between performance and quality mode remaster of the PS3 price reveal. This is their $599 moment, rebuilt and restored for 2024 for all to enjoy. We're back.
How many will enjoy this, though? That's the question. Come November 7th. Obviously, we here at IGN, we're probably gonna do a lot of comparisons to the Pro and the PS, the base, the original. I guess the verdict is, I don't want to decide for everyone here. Well, what is the verdict? Like, Max, are you gonna get this? Are you thinking about getting it for the second room, the spare room that you have? I've never been to your house, so I don't know if you have a spare room.
I mean, I'm in the spare room right now. It's full of crap. It's where I do the videos and stuff. But no, I don't know. Like, maybe at some point I'll jump on this thing. Like, again, if the prospect of a price cut ever happens, maybe. But like, also right now, what's the purpose? Like, again, Wolverine gets me excited. GTA 6 gets me excited. Those are a long ways off. I really hope that, I mean, TGS is in a couple of weeks. It seems like a pretty cool opportunity for Sony to come out and be like, hey, we're actually making some new games. Check them out and get people excited about what 2025 looks like. One of the things we were going to talk about on this episode, if we hadn't just gone so hard on the PS5 Pro, was how last year it was hard to pick one game of the year because there were so many big, huge, massive games. And this year it's been kind of dry. There have been some cool games here and there, but none of them really feel like, you know, quantifiable, you know, capital G-O-T-Y games of the year. And I'm hoping 2025 is a big one. Like, I'm hoping that Sony has some stuff to show off besides maybe Wolverine and then, you know, GTA 6. Like, GTA 6 is going to suck all the air out of the room and that's going to dominate the conversation. That's going to be a killer game. I'd like to play another game besides that. You know, probably there's probably going to be, you know, at least 6 months between the ball dropping on New Year's and that game coming out, probably more than that. So be cool to know what is actually on the horizon. Besides Lego Horizon, which is coming to Switch.
Yes, yeah, it is.
Favorite PlayStation game is this year's hottest Switch title. I don't know what you're doing.
You know what? I mean, I love video games. I want to play them at their best. I'm not exactly like a huge snob about graphics. I love the idea of the games I own looking better. I don't love the idea of me trading in my launch model PS5 and then spending that exact same money over again. Because I can tell you right now, I feel like it's going to be bare minimum $400 for me if I traded in my launch model PS5, which is an all digital that I bought for $400 in 2020, I'll probably get $300 tops back for it, right? Maybe. And I'll have to spend $400 again on this. Will I do it? I don't know. I'm stupid and I've made dumb decisions with money for most of my adult life. And this is a hobby and a passion for me. So we'll see. But I just don't right now. I don't see a reason to buy this. And I especially don't see a reason to buy this in November when there's really nothing coming from Sony day and date that says this is why you need this. They have showed us like reheated leftovers for the fifth or sixth time now for some of these games. And I'm good, man. Like I just don't see the average person walking into a store and saying, I need this because I need to play a bunch of games that are still on last gen with the best graphics possible.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
so
Jade, I'm assuming you're on the same boat as I guess the rest of us here, right?
Like, so we're... yes and no. So I may end up picking this up, and like, I am against this price point. I'm against a lot of the things, but for me, because a lot of my job personally deals with playing games for work and sometimes capturing stuff for work, being able to capture it in the best way, shape, and form, I can justify it as some sort of a work expense for me type of thing, to where I may be able to, like, that's my justification for it. As a pure consumer, probably not. But because of my job duties, sometimes it may make it justifiable. There is also, you know, like Brian was saying, we want something else, or maybe it was Max, one of you guys were saying, we want something more than GTA 6. There are some good third-party stuff that we have coming out next year that's going to make great use of this PS5 Pro. Monster Hunter Wilds is probably one of my Game of the Year choices for next year. Cannot wait for that game. There's also Dynasty Warriors Origins, I believe, is the subhead for that one. That one looks great, and I feel like that's going to be a fantastic use of the PS5 Pro. So, but also to Max and Brian's point, like, where's the first party stuff showing this? We can't rely completely on third party stuff to sell us on this next generation of the console. But I'm on the fence right now. I'm 50-50 to take the plunge.
You're one of the rare people who can actually, like, genuinely take advantage of that pro subhead. The fact that it is called a PlayStation Pro, professional as in work, but play. Yeah. But what is it? If you do gameplay capture of just absolutely kicking ass in the RE4 shooting gallery, or just mopping the floor, desperately attempting to platinum Concord before it gets shut off, like, you have a valid reason to be playing on the best possible hardware. But most people, that's not the case.
Whenever we're ready, I do have some additional news and stats that just came out on this thing too.
Well, we got to wrap soon. I'm being told, and so there's a little man in my ear who's telling me to wrap. What are these stats that you're looking at?
Real quick, Wario 64 via CNET paraphrasing, PlayStation Spectral Super Resolution will work on PSVR 2. 40 to 50 games with PS5 Pro upgrades at launch, focusing on 4K 60fps. And 25% of PS5 owners own 120fps capable TVs. Around 1 in 10 players have variable refresh rate TVs. So not even many people have TVs that will truly take advantage of this tech. So there's, I don't think we're there yet. And I think the price sucks.
I mean, even with like the PS5, you know, going up to 8K, how many people have 8K televisions? We've talked about this before. You know, I mean, I know one guy in LA that has an 8K television, and he never invites me over.
Has he played The Last of Us?
I don't know what he plays. Like I said, he never invites me over. So I don't even think the television exists in his house. But Max, Brian, Jade, I want to thank you all so much for joining me on this very special episode of Beyond. I think we covered a lot. And by a lot, I mean one topic, which I think was pretty awesome. So, So thank you all so much. Thank you all so much for watching this episode of Beyond. And we will catch you all in the next one. Beyond.
Beyond.
Love you all.
Look at me in this lonely studio.
$699 US dollars.
As we fade.